Morning to all. And first of all, I would like to thank the Mamapd College for giving me an opportunity to interact with you. And I'm so happy to see my close friends also here. The topic given to me is the innovations and trends in finance, recent innovations and trends in finance. And this topic is more or less not a technical paper, it's a more or less general one to discuss the new developments in finance. These days finance is getting, it is assuming more importance. I've been talking to Vinod sir and Gopalakrishnan sir. Recently one of my close relations is the vice president of the IBM in Asia Pacific region. And he was just telling me that now the next decade is for the finance, this explosive growth in finance, because the dynamics of economics is changing. Up to now, the economics was that was involved in the, let's say, more or less in the output and production, that means GDP for a nation is decided by the output as well as the service as well as the commodity output and growth. But these days the new economics is that sharing of the existing resource. So that means there is no new output these days that much. The whatever resource there that's shared, for example in the case of Uber, taxi, etc., a sharing of results. And because of that one, the companies are making more profit on in finance rather than in the production and distribution. That's why many companies you can see, their major area of profit these days is actually from the financial instruments, or let's say financial activity and financial process, etc. Apart from that one, in India also, now the service sector is getting more and more, or the growth in service sector is quite high. Just like insurance is opening up and banking, so there's a lot of potential. Not only in India, in world, throughout the world, just like that. So that's why the finance also is giving more importance these days. Now previously the students used to go for engineering and medical. Now the highest demand is for finance, even in Christ College in Bangalore, etc. It's difficult to get the finance compared to, but the engineering you can get easily, admission for engineering. So that's what, now, last 60 years I've witnessed significant innovations in finance and financial economics, and the rapidity with which corporate finance, bank finance and investment finance have changed in recent years. Now that actually testifies the tremendous pace which the finance is advancing. This advancement in finance is not only in financial theory, it's also in financial products, financial process, etc. Now that's a new field you might be knowing, financial engineering has emerged now to cater to the needs. So innovations advances are in, it's not limited to financial theories, it's also extends to products and financial processes. I think it is not changing. You have to control it from there. Can I control it from here? Is it possible to control it from here? Is it possible to? Sorry. Okay, then. If it's not possible, it's all right. If one. Okay. You'll be doing from there. Okay, now second, third slide now. Third slide. Innovation means actually a new thing. Development of new financial theories. For example, the portfolio management, portfolio theory, then capitalized pricing model, black shorts option pricing, etc. These are all innovative financial theories. And design and development of innovative financial products and process. Products means derivative instruments. Process means the financial engineering products like ATM and etc. Now these innovations are, they formulate creative solutions to new financial problems, challenges. For example, development of such innovative financial theories like Markowitz efficient frontier theorem or portfolio theory, Sharpe CAPM capitalized pricing model, Modigliani and Miller irrelevance theorem, capital structure and dividend, and also the efficient market hypothesis, behavioral finance, etc. These are all actually new developments in financial theory. Now, it actually, the explosive growth now came 60 years back with the Markowitz efficient frontier model. Next one. The products includes, innovation products include the futures, options, swaps, that's the derivative instruments, as well as the junk bonds and structured instruments like the strips, etc. These are actually the new generation products in finance to cater to the needs of the financing problem, financing the investment. And next one. The process involved the program trading, innovative financial process like program trading. Program trading is actually, it is assuming more and more importance these days. Now by investment banks are normally using program trading to take a position in the case of the derivative instrument as well as the financial instruments to make profit. Now these are automated now these days. Considering the risk and return of the products, automated program trading is done, and highly mathematical algorithms are used for program trading. That means program trading acts like this. It actually, now the system learns the behavior of the investors, and on the basis of that it will predict how investors will now react to a specific news item. On the basis of that one, what changes will happen in the case of the asset pricing, and on the basis of that one, they either buy or sell the asset to make profit. So these algorithms are now getting more and more importance, so that predictive capabilities improved. Now, unlike the retail investors like us, the institution investors, they have specialized proprietary program trading, the software, etc. With that one, they can learn the behavior of the investors, and how, when there's a shock in the financial market, how the different price, asset price will react. For example, when it's a shock just like the Brexit, at that time what happened was, some of the stocks, now in the case of steel industry, and steel, most of the other commodity stock, as well as the other financial stocks, shares, now they converge to the steel industry, so that we can use that one, that information for diversification and making profit. So creative trading process like program trading, global linkages among exchanges. Global linkages among exchanges means now different exchanges are linked now. It is trading is 24 hours. For example, take the IIMX, that means Singapore Exchange, that's linked to NASDAQ and NYSE. By after the Singapore Exchange closed by 4 o'clock in the evening, by that time NASDAQ and NYSE would be open, New York Stock Exchange. So it will be linked to that one, so you can trade it through that one. So arbitrage is possible. Now arbitrage, profit can be made across space, time, etc. Space means the different countries you can. Time, 24 hours, actually the stock market is functioning 24 hours. That's the exchange. Now, then money transfer and money management vehicles, like you know that ATM, FPOS. ATM is used for money transfer across space and time. You can transfer money instantaneously from India to US, and also at any time you can transfer. Now, ATM, as well as FPOS, That means the credit card, etc., these are used. Now, these are all actually products of financial engineering. SPV is special purpose vehicle for financing specific projects. That means financing, SPV is used for that one, special purpose vehicle. And how it is actually the stimulated, the innovation. Innovation, the main reason for the innovations are the frictions in the financial market. Frictions in the financial market, that means in different market, the asset pricing would be different and cost structure would be different, etc. Second would be the asymmetry of information. Now, some information will be available in some market, won't be available in the other market, and so on. So asymmetry would be there. And also third one, asymmetry in tax structure also. These are the reasons for the explosive growth in the field of the finance. And regulatory changes, of course, competition, etc. We go to the each one of these, briefly discuss each one of these. Now, first one, we will go to the innovations in the financial theory. First one is the Markowitz portfolio theory. Now, many of you will be knowing this is like the big bang in modern finance, the Markowitz theory. Professor Harry Markowitz has formulated the portfolio theory. He is said to be the father of the portfolio theory. And it also marks the birth of the modern financial economics. Professor Markowitz, in the Journal of Finance in March 1952, provided an analytical framework for investment process by giving the first time the precise definition of what is risk and return. Now, previously, before 1952, investors used to have a naive strategy for investment on tips and rumors. But Professor Markowitz provided an analytical framework, a scientific framework for making investment decision. Now, the theory assumes that the investors are rational. Rational means, now they are not actually controlled by emotions. Now they are rational means they go for higher return for lower return. So rational, investors are rational. And so because of that one, the major thing we have to consider for investment is the risk and return of the security before making investment. Now, return risk go together. So if you want to get higher return, now you have to take more risk. And if you want to reduce the risk, you have to compromise the return. So, but the problem is that how to quantify risk and return. Now that's what he provided an algebraic mathematical expression for that one, for the quantifying the risk and return. For this theory, Professor got the Nobel Prize a few years back in economics. Specifically, Markowitz identified return of investment with the expected value of the probability weighted mean, value of its possible outcome. That means now the return of a stock is actually, it has got a probability distribution. Normally we assume normal distribution for that one. It depends upon the outcome, state of nature. For example, consider this case. You want to consider the case of the fertilizer industry. The fertilizer industry, return of the, if you are holding the stock of the FACT or some other, let's say some other company, its return depends upon the revenue of the company. When companies make more revenue, more profit would be made, more dividend would be paid, and the components of return would be dividend and price change. So that would be price would be will be higher, as well as the dividend would be high. So return and revenue are closely related. So when the companies making, fertilizer companies make more profit, then in that case, its stock return will also be high. Return per shares would be high. And the revenue of the fertilizer company depends upon certain factors. For example, the monsoon, state of monsoon. Now the monsoon might be in a year. It can be either normal, above normal, or below normal. Suppose monsoon is above normal, then obviously the company would be making, fertilizers would be used more, and company would be earning more revenue. Same is true with the umbrella also. Monsoon is high, umbrella industry would be flourishing. Is that clear? Now, normal means that also it will be making profit not this much as the above normal. Now it's below normal, the company would be making less revenue, so it will be making less profit, so return on stock would be low. So return on stock here depends upon state of nature, that means the state of monsoon. Suppose the probability that next year the monsoon is above normal is, let's say 0.5, normal is 0.3, and below normal is 0.2. Probability, that's the outcome, the probability of the outcome. Outcome would be this state of monsoon. And suppose the profit, the return of the stock, when it's above normal is 15%, normal is, let's say, 10%, and below normal 5%. Then, according to Harry Markowitz, the return is the expected return. Multiply probability and add, that is one. Weighted average of that one. Weight is the probability weighted. Is that clear? So that's how it's quantified. So first time he gave how to quantify the return, an expression. That is the weighted average, that is the return as an expected value of the probability weighted mean. And how do you measure the risk? Risk is the unexpected variation return. Unexpected variation return. Now you expect certain outcome. Suppose the actual outcome is different than this risk. Is that clear? So that is measured by the variation around the mean. That is the standard deviation or variance of the return. Standard deviation variance of the return is the risk. That's how it is measured. Please remember, in finance, risk means upside potential and downside risk, both upside and downside. We might think that risk is only loss. It's not like that one. Now, even if the return is unexpected, it's higher or lower than expected, there's a risk. That way, even if return is higher, there's a risk. Because whatever goes up will come down. That is the principle. So that's the, by identifying the return, the Markowitz makes powerful algebra of mathematical statistics now available for the study of the portfolio selection. Most important aspect of Markowitz theory is to show that it is not the security's own risk that is relevant for investor. It is the contribution of security towards total risk of the portfolio. Now that is the most important thing. An investor's actual risk is not risk of individual securities holding. It is the risk of the portfolio he is holding. Now that means, now an investor will not invest all the securities in only in one security. His wealth he will not now invest or in only one security. To reduce the risk, he will be investing in a couple of securities. That's all we all know. So that means now to reduce the risk, he will be now combining different securities into a portfolio. That's a portfolio. A portfolio is a group of assets held as an investment. So he will be constructing a portfolio to reduce the risk. This process is known as diversification. So investors will diversify. And the real risk of an investor is not individual risk. It is the risk of the portfolio. How much risk the security is contributing to the portfolio. For example, now in the case of the securities, the return might be either positively correlated or negatively correlated, or there won't be any correlation. If it's negatively correlated, when one security's return increases, the other will be reducing. So that will compensate. Is that clear? Compensate. So that means a portfolio risk would be lower than that of the individual securities risk. Individual securities might be coming risk, but portfolio risk might be lower if it is a negative correlation. There's a negative correlation among the returns of the securities. Take the case of the Amul ice cream, as well as the umbrella, John's umbrella. The stock of John's umbrella depends upon the state of monsoon. If monsoon is high, the return would be high. Normal return, less than low, then lower return. And in the case of ice cream Amul, if the monsoon is high, lower return, the opposite, is that clear? And normal, and below normal, higher return, monsoon. So that means these are negatively correlated. So one security is, now loss might be compensated with another security. That's the advantage of combining the into portfolio. So the real risk of the investor is the portfolio, the risk of the portfolio. How much contribution each security is now making in the case of the portfolio risk. And this measure will be covariance. of the security returns, the covariance. So covariance is also important. So diversification, how to diversify, portfolio selection problem is explained, or that is answered by the Markowitz portfolio theory, Harry Markowitz portfolio theory. That's one of the major innovations in the financial theory. Second innovation in financial theory is the capital asset pricing model. That's second one, capital asset pricing model. This is actually formulated by William Sharp, John Littner, and Jan Mazin, and it's an extension of Markowitz portfolio theory. Capital asset pricing model, now it is actually an equilibrium model. So it is actually, now it provides how irrational investors should behave. Now, if they invest according to Markowitz theory, how they should behave? Now, if it is they invest according to Markowitz theory. So, CAPM derives a linear relationship between the risk and return of security as well as portfolio. Linear relationship between security and return and risk. That is, security as well as portfolio, linear relationship between risk and return. That's the capital asset pricing model. Now, this is actually an equilibrium model, and the expression is given by RA equal to RF plus beta into RM minus RF. That is return, RA is the return of security, RF is the risk-free rate of return, beta is beta of the security, that measures sensitivity of security return to return of the market portfolio, and RM is the return of the market portfolio. So that is the capital asset pricing model. It gives a linear relationship. RA, you can see that relationship is linear, and if you plot it on a graph, it's known as a security market line. That's security market line, or SML. And this gives the return of security is given by RI, and beta is the slope of the security market line. The slope, it measures sensitivity of the securities return to the return of the market portfolio. Market portfolio is the portfolio constructed with all the securities in the market. All securities in the market. That's the market portfolio. And it affects only one company. So that system, that's an unsystematic risk. And the fall in index or GDP growth and interest rate growth, etc. Interest rate changes, GDP changes, etc. affect the return of almost all securities. So this systematic risk. That means it affects almost all securities. The GDP, changes in GDP, changes in inflation, changes in interest rate, etc. That affect almost all securities return. So it's a systematic risk. And systematic risk measured by beta. Beta measures the sensitivity of the stock's return to return of the return of the market portfolio. And that's measured by beta. Total risk is measured by the sigma, standard deviation or variance, and unsystematic risk by alpha, variation alpha. That is one. So that's why capital asset pricing model states that unsystematic risk can be diversified away by the investor. It is within the control of the investor, so market will not reward for that one. Only thing he cannot diversify away is the systematic risk. So market will compensate only for systematic risk. So the real risk faced by the investor is systematic risk. So the correct expression for the risk is beta naught sigma. That's why beta is used here in the expression. You can see that beta is used in the expression. Okay, the other one. I'll come to that one. Just a minute. I'll tell you which one. 23. Slide 23. Okay. Wonderful. 23, in the financial theory. Modigliani-Miller theorem, Riemann theorem, is formulated by Franco Modigliani as well as the Mert-Miller. And this theory states that the capital structure or dividend policy is not irrelevant for the value of the firm. It doesn't influence the value of the firm. That is the theorem. That means capital structure is the debt equity ratio mix. That as well as the dividend policy will not affect the value of the firm. That's the theorem. So in this case, I go up to 115, no sir? 115, okay. Okay. Now, for example, consider the case of you are buying a house. It cost you, let's say, 10 lakh, price 10 lakh. To finance that one, you can use either a debt or your own fund, or that's not equity, your own fund or a mix. Assume that you bought the house using your own finance. So 10 lakh is the value of the your asset or value of your house, and you are financing the equity, 10 lakh. So if you draw the balance sheet, asset side it will be now the asset, 10 lakh. Liability side, equity, 10 lakh. If I ask you, if I want to buy that one house, how much would be the price you charge? You say 10 lakh, isn't it? That's the price. So value of asset is the value of value of the asset is the value of the firm. Value of the asset is the value of the firm. You say 10 lakh. Now after this, financing this with equity, 10 lakh, you changed your mind. Now you thought that you'll get a bank loan. A bank loan you'll get. That means 4 lakh you get bank loan. Now bank loan for this house. On security of that one, you procured 4 lakh, and that 4 lakh you took yourself. Now the capital structure or financing pattern is 6 lakh equity, 4 lakh debt. 6 lakh equity and 4 lakh debt. Is that clear? Previously, capital structure debt equity ratio was 1 is to 0. Now it is, now 6 lakh is to 4 lakh. Debt equity ratio is 4 lakh is to 6 lakh. Previously, 0 is to 1. Now, did it change the value of the asset? If I ask you again, would you like to sell it to me, how much I give, how much you want? You say again, now 10 lakh, didn't change. So when you change the financing pattern, didn't change the asset value. So financing is the capital structure decision is or dividend decision is a purely financial decision. So it doesn't create any value. Value is created by the right-hand side of the balance sheet, by superior managerial decision and investment decision. Now, the left-hand side actually gives how you share the value. How you share the value. That investor share is 4 lakh and the share of the equity investor is 6 lakh. That is the one. Exactly, it didn't change the value. This is the MM theorem. Exactly. Now, that means capital structure and purely financial decision will not change the value of the firm. It's not depend upon the value of the firm. Now, this one, for example, a purely financing, that's because purely financing decision doesn't have any value. Its NPV is zero. Consider the NPV of this financing decision. Now, what you've done previously, let's say, put it like this. You want to change the financing pattern by procuring loan. What is the NPV of that decision? Let's see. Now, you're getting an inflow of 4 lakh, the loan, and you are using paying back the equity, 4 lakh. So inflow and outflow is now the zero. The net is, net present value is zero. Isn't it clear? So it doesn't create any value, that's fine. Okay, that's the MM. MM proved this hypothesis by an arbitrage process. Now the innovations in instruments, that's what we are going to do. Derivative instruments, first one. That is the derivative instrument is, you all know, most of you, the contract that gives the contract holder either an obligation or a choice to buy or sell a financial asset some future time. It will either provide an obligation or a choice to buy or sell a financial asset or commodity, whatever would be that one. And the its value depends upon the value of the underlying asset. A derivative instrument is a contract which gives a, now, which actually gives a choice or an obligation, and its value depends upon the value of the underlying asset. Example would be like this. Suppose you want to, your daughter's wedding is there, and you want to buy gold. Is that clear? Buy gold. And suppose daughter's wedding is now, you have to buy the gold, and for that you have to pay immediately. So the gold will be getting from the dealer, the gold, and you'll be paying immediately. Such a transaction is cash transaction. Now, cash on delivery. Another type of transaction would be like this. Now, your daughter's wedding is only after 1 year. And suppose the value of the gold now, at present, spot price, it's on the spot price. Present value is rupees 2000 per gram. 2000 per gram, spot price. Your daughter's wedding is only next year, so you have to buy it only next year. But you are concerned that the price might go up next year, by next year. It might go up to 2500, let's say, next year. That's your expectation. So you want a protection against that one. If you wait, you will be having a loss. So you're going to a dealer and say, would you give me the price of gold at which you sell me after 1 year? After 1 year, how much you charge the price? He'll be prepared to give you, he'll say, now I'll give you a price of 2500 per gram. Is that clear? 2500 per gram. Now it is 2000. So you can enter into a contract. That's such a contract known as a forward contract. In a forward contract, the delivery will take place only after, now in future. But you will enter into contract now. Both parties are obliged to perform. After 1 year, dealer has to give you gold at 2500 and whatever be the actual price after 1 year. He has to give you the gold at 2500. You have to pay 2500. Suppose gold price goes down to 2000. Still you have to give 2500 to him and buy it from him. And you will be losing. Suppose gold price increases to 3000, you will be gaining. You have to give only 2500 and dealer has to give you 2500. This is a forward contract, the simplest form of the derivative instrument. Is that clear? So that's the simplest form. In this case, in this upside and downside, upside potential, you can make loss, gain, or you can make loss, downside also. So that's the derivative instrument. This is a derivative instrument. Chief economic function of derivative instrument is to provide ways to control risk. Now, derivative instruments are not limited to financial asset. They are now extend to commodities also, precious metals, etc. The different types of derivative instruments are forward contract, now the futures contract, options as well as the swap. Forward contract is a non-standardized and non-exchange traded contract to buy or sell an asset on a future date. Now, it can be contrasted with spot contract that we already seen, and forward contracts used for hedging. Futures contract is also a special type of forward contract, but it's traded only through exchange. Say exchange traded and standardized contract, futures contract. That's another derivative instrument. That's also used for hedging. Options contract. Suppose for forward and futures contract, there's an upside and downside. Suppose you want to have only the upside. You want to cut the downside. You don't want to the downside. In that case, you have to go to for an options contract. An options contract gives you a right to buy or not to buy. Doesn't give you an obligation. Gives a choice to buy, not to buy. Because in this case, the risk is taken by the dealer, he'll charge a premium, options premium he'll charge. Is that clear? So advance for options contract is that, now it is actually, this one upside is there, downside risk is not there for an options contract. For that compensation should be paid, that is the premium, options premium. In that this is quite a versatile instrument. Different strategies can be used for the options. There are two types of option, call option. Put option, call option gives a right to buy. Put option gives a right to sell. Now, options are, this is one of the major innovations in the recent innovation finance, that is Black-Scholes equation. Options are actually valued by using Black-Scholes option pricing model. It's a highly mathematical complex equation, a solution to a second order differential equation, and actually it's borrowed from the physics, from thermodynamics. And for this, the for see, capitalized pricing model, the William Sharp got the Nobel Prize, and for options, Black and Scholes got the Nobel Prize. Merton is also involved, but Merton died before the Nobel Prize, so Nobel Prize not given after the death. So that's why. So this is the complex equation for option. Now, Black-Scholes equation is a major innovation. Now, look at this equation. It's for a European call option. And there are two parts here, S0 and D1 and X e raised to minus RT. One part is actually options exchange traded, as well as the over-the-counter, investment banks wholesale. Problem is that if you normally dealers take option, the position option, that would be billions of dollars. So if you take in exchange traded options will not be available to that amount, and even if you take that one, high volatility would be there. So because that one, you have synthesized an option, that you use the Black-Scholes equation. Black-Scholes equation you can, using S0 and D1 is now the stock. If you call the stock, as well as the other one is the XE risk minus RT is the bond. If you hold a specific proportional stock and bond, you can synthesize the options payoff. And that is used by the investment bankers where substantial amount is required. This is known as option replication strategy. Swap is the third one. A swap is actually an exchange of options used for corporate risk management and price risk, covering the price risk, option futures and the forward contract. Swap is an exchange of either one type of cash flow, one asset for another asset, one liability for another liability, or one stream of cash flow for another stream of cash flow. That is the swap. A financial swap is an agreement between two parties to exchange a series of cash flows over a specified period of time or specific terms. For example, I'll come to that one example later. There are two types of swaps, interest rate swap and currency swap. In interest rate swap, one type of interest payment is exchanged for another type of interest payment. Fixed rate payment for floating rate payment or vice versa. And currency swap, now the one currency is exchanged for another currency. Difference that interest rate swap, principal is not exchanged. Only interest would be exchanged. In currency swap, both the principal as well as the interest are now exchanged. That's the difference. Now, for example, this is the, consider this one. I don't know whether it's clear to you. Now, 4 or 5, this is a diagram there. If you just go down, that's one. Now, this is a currency swap between IBM and World Bank. This is the first swap design between IBM and World Bank. IBM is a US company, and World Bank is a, now that's also in US. But IBM, at that time, IBM has got more credit rating in Europe. So it can borrow at a lower rate, IBM. That's in 1982, first swap. And World Bank has got more credit rating in the US. It can borrow at a lower rate in US. So World Bank can borrow US dollar at now lower rate in the US, and IBM can borrow the Swiss franc at a lower rate in Europe because it's got more credit rating. And the requirement of IBM was at that time the US dollar, where it has to pay more interest. And requirement of World Bank was Swiss franc, and where it has to pay now more interest. So what they've done, they designed a swap like this. Now at that time the exchange rate was $1 equal to Swiss franc. So IBM's requirement was now $100 million and Swiss franc, sorry, World Bank's 200 million Swiss franc equal requirement. So what they done, they designed a swap like this. Now IBM borrowed in the market where it is got now lower, let's say lower interest, that is in the US, sorry, in Switzerland. It borrowed in Switzerland, and the interest rate was for World Bank, it is 12%, sorry, Swiss franc is 12%, and the dollar 8%. World Bank is to pay 8% and IIM has to pay 12% versus franc. So IIM got lower rate in Switzerland, so it borrowed Swiss franc. But its requirement is US dollar. And the World Bank borrowed in US, where it's got lower interest rate and at the 8%. And its requirement is Swiss franc. They borrowed in their currency where they got advantage and swapped, exchanged. So IIM exchanged the Swiss franc to the World Bank, and World Bank exchanged the principal amount. Now, principal amount to the World Bank, the dollar to IIM, and they exchange the principal amount initially and interest periodically, exactly, and also the re-exchange the principal at the end of the tenure. So by this way, both parties now requirements satisfied, and they got a lower interest or savings also interest. This is how a swap works. Let's see. Now we go to the efficient market hypothesis. Efficient market hypothesis formulated by Ewan Farmer. He got the Nobel Prize 2 years back for this one, for efficient market hypothesis. It's a revolutionary theory. His PhD thesis, efficient market hypothesis, states that the market is efficient, capital market is efficient. So it states that capital market are efficient and stock price move in a random way, because that means also known as random market theory. EMH assumes that investors are rational and the market is said to be efficient when all information affecting the, what is efficient market? Efficient market is a market where all information affecting the stock price are available to all investors. It's instantaneously incorporated in stock price. That is the efficient market. So because that one, the stock price may not move in, will not move in patterns and waves. It moves in, now let's say, the in a random way. That's the efficient market hypothesis. Farmer defined efficient market as security price always fully reflect the available information. And there are three forms of efficiency: weak form, semi-strong form, and strong form. If the market is in weak form, market is said to be in weak form, if all the historical information is incorporated in the current price. Now, so technical analysis is not useful, because that one, technical analysis which uses historical price. Market is semi-strong when publicly available information is, as well as the historical information is now incorporated in the stock price. That means even fundamental analysis will not be useful where we use publicly available information. And market is strong form where insider information would be now available to all investors. That means the information available to privileged persons like top management and stock exchange officials. Actually, this is not, market is not in strong form in any country, because insider information will not be available to the all investors. In India, it is actually semi-strong form. Now, the insider information, you can earn abnormal profit because of the, if market is not efficient. For example, strong form of efficiency assumes that now all information, that is even inside information, is available to all investors. Take the case of the Mangalore refinery, MRPL. A few years back, Mangalore refinery was actually now in a substantial loss, and the stock price was only 8 rupees, face value was 10 rupees. Then the cash rich ONGC, they want to acquire a refinery. So they decide to acquire MRPL. Obviously, what happened? MRPL would be, now it will be now reviving the business, high profit would be earned, so stock price will go up. But before announcing this one, the top management extra knew this one. And at that time, the price was 8 rupees. This is inside information. They bought the stock, 8 rupees. And after the announcement was made, stock price went up to 40 rupees. So they sold that one. So that is the abnormal profit was earned. This is not available to normal investors. That's one. So, 2 minutes. Okay. All right, so that is the efficient market hypothesis. Contradictory to efficient market hypothesis that behavioral finance. And behavioral finance, it states that Of course, market would be efficient if there is no investor bias in the market. But investors normally will not act in a rational way. Emotional aspects would be that would be creep in the investment decision. Because that one there will be investor bias would be present in the stock market. So market is not efficient all the time. Investor bias like loss aversion and mental, let's say, counting, etc. would be present. So because that one market is not efficient. That's a new theory, behavioral finance. Now, there are different types of investment biases. Now, focus on investors' behavior and decision making. Contrary to the next slide. Contrary to the traditional paradigm, behavioral finance assumes that agents may be irrational and the reactions to new information and investment decision. Source of irrationality are psychological biases as well as heuristic. These are the ones. Now, next one. As a result, market will not always be efficient and asset pricing may be deviate from predictions. For example, this behavioral finance was first now identified by J.P. Morgan. And J.P. Morgan identified certain behavioral bias in the market and they invested, the investment strategy was now structured by taking into account these behavioral biases. So what they've done, they moved according to the behavioral biases and then whenever now there's a turn they'll be, at that time they'll change their investment strategy. Because that one last 20 years, J.P. Morgan earned their fund, earned always profit because that one, J.P. Morgan. And an example of the behavioral finance, the bias would be like this. 2 minutes? Okay, example would be like this. I'll give an example. Now consider this case. You are going for the IPL, the cricket tournament. You bought a ticket for that one by paying 10,000. Suppose venue is Mumbai. You bought ticket 10,000 and put in a pocket. You are traveling by bus and it was actually pickpocketed, that means you lost the ticket by pickpocketing. You lost the ticket. You'll be having a regret, no? You spent 10,000. You lost that one. And when you reach the gate, question is, would you buy another ticket? Would you buy another ticket? That's one. Now consider another situation. You are going to the venue for the IPL league in Mumbai. And you didn't buy the ticket, but you have 10,000 in pocket. And you lost that by pickpocket. That means someone took that one. That 10,000, you didn't buy the ticket, you lost the cash. Now when you reach the venue, would you buy a ticket then? Where the probability is high? The probability will be high in the second case because in the first case you now associate your loss to ticket. So if I take another ticket then I'll be having more loss, you might think. Second case you are losing the cash, so you don't associate with the ticket. Exactly, if I ask you the question, now you'll say, now probability of buying second ticket is more in second case because lost cash, you don't associate with the ticket. So probability is high. So this is a bias actually. You lost in both cases, you are having loss, but still you're going for that one. Another one is the Monte experiment. Now Monte is actually a TV presenter in US and his Monte show. It is like this. And Monte would be inviting the audience, would be there. He'll invite one of the person in the audience. There'll be three doors. And behind each door, they say, behind one door, they say, an expensive car, Mercedes, expensive car, behind one door. He'll ask the investor to choose the door. If he opens that one, if there is car, then he'll be getting that one. Exactly. Now, that's a gift for him, that car. Now, three doors, behind that one door, there's a car. Other two, there's no car. And he invites one of the audience. Ask him to choose one of the door and the probability of winning the prize is 1/3. Is that clear? Suppose he choose one door. What Monte will do, he'll open a door where there is no car. Now he say, I'll open this one and see what happens. Then open one of the door where there is no car. Then he asks the same participant, would you want to change your decision? Now 90% will not change the decision. They stick to same decision. Actually, the probability change, half, one-third, half. Still, you won't change your decision. It's a bias, behavioral bias. So these are the bias present, and this behavioral finance actually deals with that one. Now, I'll just wind up the session now. You are hungry, I am also hungry, and there's no point in both of us will be losing the concentration. I thoroughly enjoyed the session with you. I don't know whether you enjoyed it or not. And I once again thank the Mamapd College for giving me the opportunity. Now, all the best in life, and have a nice day, ladies and gentlemen. Now, that's normally termed in the name of that country. For example, Yankee Bond is actually in the US. Exactly? Yankee Bond. And just like Masala Bond is actually Indian, a bond issued in a foreign country. Now, to indicate it's an Indian, normally you use the Masala because it's an Indian term, no? So that's the, that's why it's used. Pudame, bond issued in a foreign country. That's the one. Because more and more countries are, the fintech is contributing for the development of finance, and within India also it's possible. Definitely, it's possible. And because that's the, as I told you in the beginning, this actually acquiring more importance. Companies are making now more profit in the financial, in finance, rather than production and distribution. And for this, new innovation solutions are provided by financial technology, as well as new opportunities also provided. That's the question for you. And cryptocurrency is actually, at present it's speculative, but then all the new things, innovation first would be, now that is, will not be accepted by the market first, then gradually they'll accept. So gradually, now that will also become more popular, India also, because iron out the, at present people are a bit, let's say, concerned about the speculative aspect, risk, and as well as the whether it can be trusted and so on. Just like the cashless transaction, the security is there and so on. Okay? And my view is that after some years, that will also get more or less popular, that one. How it is going? Because the central bank should accept that one at one point of stage, and what steps will take, regulation, etc. That all we cannot say now. For example, the derivative instruments were considered to be the speculative, and many countries thought that it won't be now permitted by different economies. But see what happens now.